thank you so much for your invitation. After the talk of Luis Aponte the last 2 weeks, I will talk about microsurgical reconstruction after tumor resection. The goal of this presentation is to describe the principle of microsurgical reconstruction after tumor resection, as well as to present a summary of our experience in the last 10 years, which made us to define the indication of such reconstructive procedures. The main principle of treating oncological patients, as you know, is to obtain with the limb sparing surgery the same oncological prognosis that we can obtain with amputation. Another very important principle is about the multidisciplinary team that has to be involved during the management of this patient. Oncologists, radiotherapists, pathologists, oncological orthopedic surgeon, and finally the reconstructive microsurgeon. Although the safety and efficacy of upper limb salvage has been well established, careful patient selection is imperative for a successful outcome. If the performance of a complete and satisfactory limb-preserving oncologic resection could result in significant loss of function despite reconstruction, then amputation should be considered. The important question to us is not whether the limb can be salvaged, but whether it should be. There are some differences between the defects produced by tumor resection and those produced by trauma. In the first group, the defects are most of the time preoperative plan and circumscribed, which is an advantage. However, depending on the tumor, some of them receive radio or chemotherapy, which can affect the result of the reconstruction, as well as the hypercoagulability state of this patient. In contrast, the defects produced by trauma are surrounded by tissues that suffer a blunt trauma and can affect the recipient vessels of a free flap or the pedicle of a local flap. The goal of reconstruction in upper extremity are to restore not just the function, but also, when possible, the aesthetics. Microsurgical techniques allow for reconstruction with the principle of like with like, meaning the different tissues could be replaced by the same tissues. Regarding the time of microsurgical reconstruction, codina original adipocate gown coverage within 72 hours of injury to prevent tissue fibrosis, infection, and edema that may complicate local or free flap coverage. Moreover, codina's seminal article did not differentiate between upper and lower extremity injuries. However, his recommendation was related to soft tissue defect in trauma patients. Nowadays, there is a controversial information about the timing of microsurgical reconstruction, even in oncological patients. While there is information against the delay reconstruction because this approach yields a higher rate of complication, as it was shown by Sanyek and Shu, who found a 100% gown complication rate in patients with delay reconstruction. However, the delay reconstruction was not defined as a protocol, but as a treatment of an already complicated wound after primary closure. Few years ago, we treated a case that we defined as an index case to develop a protocol for treating patients with a coverage defect after a soft tissue sarcoma resection. The case was about a male patient of 65 years old who was referred to our hospital after a recurrent leiomyosarcoma of his left ankle. In the same surgery, the oncological team made oncological resection and we performed the reconstruction of the soft tissue defect with a reverse flow sural flap. The immediate postoperative period was uneventful, but at 10 days, the histopathology examination showed a compromised margin, so a below knee amputation was indicated. Besides increased risk to disseminate malignant cell to the surgical field in a case of a local flap requiring a secondary more aggressive approach, the flap reconstruction has also an increased morbidity for the patient. In this study, the author using a propensity score analysis compared the surgical functional and oncological outcomes between patients undergoing flap reconstruction, and those receiving primary gown closure for limb-preserving surgery for soft tissue sarcoma. They found that patients with flap reconstruction had increased morbidity associated with flap reconstruction, mainly related to gown complication, hospital stay, and a lower MSTS score when compared to patients with primary closure, matched for patient and tumor characteristic at presentation. So, as a consequence of that case, we defined a treatment protocol for patients with soft tissue defect after sarcoma resection, either after primary resection or after unplanned resection. The protocol is defined as follows: an oncological resection alongside the back therapy application until the final histology confirmed the complete resection of the tumor, and the reconstruction with the flap in a delayed manner. To illustrate our protocol treatment, I am going to present the following case. This is a case of a 27 years old man, manual worker, who underwent an unplanned resection of a tumor at his right wrist. The result of the pathology was a fibromyxoid sarcoma, and he was referred to our hospital for oncological treatment. A wide resection was planned by the oncological team. The oncological resection includes the resection of the extensor digitorius communis, extensor indices propius, and extensor digiti quinti at the zone 6-8 of Verdun. A large cobra defect of the dorsal hand, wrist, and distal third of the forearm was created. As a protocol, the reconstruction was delayed. However, the extensor carpi radialis brevis and longus, the extensor pollicis longus, and the extensor carpi ulnaris tendon were exposed, as you can see in this picture. So to avoid tendon necrosis, we use an amniotic membrane to cover them, and then a back therapy was applied. After 2 weeks, the pathology showed that the proximal margin was not enough, so a wider resection was carried out, and we performed the first time of extensor tendon reconstruction with silicone rolls. To reconstruct the soft tissue defect, an homolateral ALT flap of 17 by 7.5 centimeters was designed. As usual, the recipient vessels were prepared before the flap was harvested. In this case, the radial artery and comitant veins were selected. The dissection of the flap was suprafacial to raise a thin flap. A muscular perforator was dissected from the vastus lateralis muscle till the descending branch of the lateral femoral circumflex artery. Thinning of the flap was also performed before the insetting to avoid bulkiness of the flap. A thin flap is nourished by the subdermal vascular plexus. The insetting of the flap showed a good contour of the dorsal aspect of the hand. 12 weeks after the first time, we performed the second time of the extensor tendon reconstruction by passing the tendons graft through the synovial sheath developed by the silicone rolls. By means of a tenodesis maneuver, we test the tendon graft tension. He followed a postoperative rehabilitation protocol with an occupational therapist. And this is the functional and cosmetic result and 6 months postoperative. The patient returned to his previous manual work with no limitation. We have applied this protocol for 7 years. Although we have had 95% of flap survival, which is an expected rate of survival, the most important findings were that 33% of cases have to be either amputated or underwent a re-excision because of positive margins. So, what are the indications for microsurgical reconstruction after tumor resection? In our Department of Orthopedics, the main indication of microsurgical reconstruction in oncological patients are soft tissue defects, bony defects, or compound defects, mainly osteocutaneous. Regarding soft tissue defects, the indications are related to the exposed critical zone, meaning bone, tendon, or nerve, as we saw with the last case, as well as of patients who will undergo adjuvant radiotherapy in order to avoid radiotherapy over an unstable scar. Microsurgical reconstruction of bony defects are limited to osteocutaneous defects, allograft complications such as infection or fracture, and in those defects which are then underwent neoadjuvant radiotherapy. I'm going to present some cases to show you the strategy and algorithm of reconstruction in our department. The first cases are about soft tissue defects. This is a case about a 65-year-old man with a soft tissue tumor on his left armpit who underwent an unplanned resection elsewhere. Histology revealed a liposarcoma, and he was referred to our hospital for treatment. After reviewing the case by the multidisciplinary team, a wide resection was planned, and according to our protocol, a back therapy was applied until the histology result. At 2 weeks postoperative, a re-excision was planned because of a compromised margin. Again, a back therapy was applied. At 1 week, we performed the final reconstruction of the soft tissue defect with a TDAP flap. This flap is based on a muscular perforator of the thoracodorsal artery, which is a nutrient artery of the latissimus dorsi muscle. It was described by Angrigiani, an Argentinian plastic surgeon. After dissecting the pedicle, we evaluated length with the shoulder in abduction to avoid traction of the pedicle during the early rehabilitation period. You can see in this picture the final insetting of the flap and the closure of the donor site. At 4 week postoperative, the patient had complete wound healing. In this case, the flap provide an aesthetic result, but the most important is that reconstruction avoid a retractile scar of the armpit. I would like to introduce some concept about perforator flaps, such as the TDAP flap I just presented. Perforator flaps represent an evolution of the knowledge of vascular anatomy of the flaps. The perforator flap era began in 1989 when Koshima and Soeda described an inferior epigastric artery skin flap without rectus abdominis muscle, noting that a large flap with that muscle could survive on a single muscle perforator. The advantages of perforator flap combine the reliable blood supply of musculocutaneous flap with the reduced donor site morbidity of a skin flap. This reduction in donor site morbidity often leads to faster recovery and reduced postoperative pain. Perforator flaps have the additional advantages that can be tailored to accurately reconstruct the defect, including flap thinning, as we saw recently. For resurfacing shallow defects, there is a freedom of orientation of a pedicle, and a longer pedicle is harvested than with the parent musculocutaneous flap. In our department, we have used mainly the ALT, the IMSAP, and the TDAP flaps. However, there is much more flap that can be used. Now I will present some anatomical characteristics of the perforator flap we have been using in the last years. First, the anterolateral type flap. This flap is supplied by either septocutaneous vessel or musculocutaneous perforator that usually arise from the descending lateral circumflex femoral artery, and the venous drainage is done by two vena comitants that accompany the arterial pedicle of the anterolateral type flap. The skin territory supplied by the vascular pedicle is very extensive. We have harvested a flap of 6 by 5 centimeters, but the flap size can be up to 25 centimeters in width and 35 centimeters in length. However, the defect after harvesting can be closed directly if the width is, in general, no more than 8 centimeters. The flap can be harvested as a combined flap to include various other tissues, including, for example, the rectus femoris muscle or the tensor fascia lata, as it is shown in the right picture. Regarding the medial sural artery perforator flap, the blood supply comes from at least one, preferably the dominant myocutaneous perforator, which develops from the medial sural artery. This vessel is usually accompanied by two vena cavitans and has its origin either from a common sural trunk, which also give rise to the lateral sural artery, or directly from the popliteal artery. For reasons such as its thinness and its long and high caliber vascular pedicle, the EMSA flap has become one of the most frequently used perforator flaps for flat and moderate size defect. The flap thickness was reported to range from 4 to 10 millimeters only, and depending on the location of the perforator, the flap pedicles varied between 5 and 14 centimeters. Finally, the thoracodorsal artery perforator flap, which was described by Angrigena, as I already told you, the artery supply of the flap is done by the perforators of the thoracodorsal artery that normally lie in a row overlying the course of the descending branch of the thoracodorsal artery. The size of the skin island is principally limited by the need for primary closure. Flap of up to 25 to by 14 centimeters have been harvested without significant problem. Although the main indication of the flap is breast reconstruction, in tumor reconstruction surgery, it is useful in soft tissue defects of the shoulder or in the arm as a pedicle flap. Now I will present you two more cases of soft tissue defect, but these cases include the functional deficit because of the tumor resection. The first case is about 26 years old woman, right-handed, who underwent an unplanned resection of a tumor located in the distal third of her dominant forearm. The histology diagnosis was a synovial sarcoma, and she was referred to our hospital. So a wide resection was planned and performed by the oncological team. The resection included the dorsal cortex of the distal radius, the extensor digitorum communis, the extensor pollicis longus, and the extensor indicis propius, and the scar of the previous surgery. As already showed you, the soft tissue reconstruction was again delayed. At 2 weeks, the histology showed free margin and the reconstructive surgery was performed. As the first case I show you, this patient has a functional deficit of the extensor tendon of the finger and thumb associated to a coverage deficit. Our strategy to treat these cases is to cover the soft tissue defect and perform the first time of the extensor tendons by using a silicone rose. Why we use this strategy instead of making the extensor tendon reconstruction in the same time? First of all, if the flap fail, we do not lose the tendon graft. Second, during the postoperative period of the free flap, the patient is immobilized, so a risk of tendon adhesion increase. On contrary, by doing an estate reconstruction of the extensor tendon, we diminish both risks. In this case, the radial pedicle was used as a recipient vessels. Coverage defect was reconstructed with a free ALT flap of 10 by 3.5 centimeter, and the first time of the extensor tendons reconstruction was performed by using silicone rope, as I already explained. In this case, the perforator was a septal one. A dynamic splint was used in the postoperative period to allow gliding of the silicone ropes. At 3 months after, the second time of the extensor tendon reconstruction was carried out by passing the tendon graft through the synovial shed developed around the silicone rods. The tension of the tendon graft was evaluated with the tenodesis maneuver, and the final cosmetic and functional result. The patient returned to the university, and now she is a dentist. The next case is about a 53 years old man who was referred because he had a tumor in his dominant right arm. The diagnosis was made by puncture biopsy, was a high-grade sarcoma. The tumor comprised the anterior compartment of the arm. The oncological team performed the tumor resection, which include most of the brachial and bicep muscles, so a compound deficit, which include not only the coverage, but the elbow flexion was created. A delayed reconstruction was planned and care was taken to cover the median and lunar nerve as well as the brachial pedicle to avoid desiccation by the back. 10 days after the tumor resection, we performed the reconstructive surgery. Our primary indication in elbow flexion or extension reconstruction is a pedicle latissimus dorsum when available. For the elbow flexion reconstruction, the latissimus dorsum was transferred by using the bipolar technique with the proximal insertion at the coracoid process and distally in the residual bicep tendon, as it was described by Sancoli and Mitra. The musculocutaneous flap allow us to reconstruct the function and the anterolateral coverage. The medial coverage was reconstructed by means of a skin graft. At 3 months follow-up, the patient regained active elbow flexion. Of course, the Sandler effect helps in the elbow flexion. Now I will show you some cases of bony defects of the upper extremity. In our hospital, segmental bone defects in the upper extremity in the context of a tumor are reconstructed by an allograft as a primary indication. However, vascularized bone grafts have shown biological superiority over non-vascularized bone, mainly in bony defects surrounded by scar, fibrotic gown beds, and bony defects caused by osteomyelitis. So we have a specific indication for microsurgical reconstruction with free fibula flap in the context of oncological defects in upper and lower extremity. These include radiation-induced fractures, allograft infection or fracture, neoadjuvant radiotherapy, or osteocutaneous defects. The fibula flap has many advantages, such as an outstanding length available for harvest, a solid and seizable bone stock, reliable bone blood supply, and a low morbidity associated with its harvest. Furthermore, from the studies of Yoshimura and Wei, in which they delineate the blood supply of the skin over the lateral aspect of the leg and identify a reliable skin perforator, an osteocutaneous flap can be safely harvested to use as a monitor or to reconstruct a composite defect. The first case is about a 12 years old boy with an osteosarcoma of his right radius. The treatment algorithm of the oncological team in our hospital related to distal radius tumor is to reconstruct with the distal radius of the articular graft as the first choice. So this was the treatment performed. However, at 6 months follow-up, the allograft got infected. Because of this, the allograft was removed, followed by a debridement, and a bone cement spacer was used to maintain the bony defect. IV antibiotics for 6 weeks were administered. After the infection was solved, the bony defect was reconstructed with a free fibular graft. Distally, the fibular graft was fixed to the proximal carpal row to avoid complete arthrodesis of the wrist. A 2 year follow-up, this is the final result. Because of the lack of the distal radio-ulnar joint, the pronation was limited. Flexor extension of the wrist at the mid-carpal joint was also limited, but the patient had no pain during the forearm or wrist range of motion. The next case is about a 37-year-old man with a giant cell tumor of his right distal radius. Again, the first indication in distal radius tumor is an osteoarticular allograft that was performed by the oncological team. However, at 8 months follow-up, a recurrence of the tumor was diagnosed and a second osteoarticular allograft was performed. Unfortunately, at 12 months follow-up, a new recurrence was diagnosed. However, in this recurrence, the tumor was locally more aggressive, involving the extensor tendon and the ulna. So, to achieve a wide resection, the radius allograft and the native ulna were resected, as well as the extensor tendon of the fingers. After resection, we used a cement spacer to fill the bone loss. After 18 months without recurrence, we perform an osteocutaneous free fibula flap for a reconstruction of a one bone forearm. Finger extension reconstruction was performed in a second time with transfer of the flexor carpi radialis tendon prolonged with a plantaris tendon to the extensor digitori communis tendon. With this reconstruction, it is important to define in the preoperative period together with the patient about achieving a complete metacarpal phalangeal extension but losing the complete fist, or having a complete fist but a limit metacarpal phalangeal extension. This is due to the lack of tenodesis effects of the wrist. According to this, the tension of the tendon transfer is regulated. At 3 years follow-up, the patient has a quick dash of 6.8 and he resumed his daily life activity without limitation. Well, now we discuss about the bony defects of the shoulder. Following the knee and proximal femur, the shoulder is the most common location of all primary bone sarcomas. The main type of reconstruction after wide resection includes shoulder arthrodesis and functional or mobile reconstruction with an osteoarticular allograft, endoprosthesis, or allograft prosthesis composites. I will present the case of a shoulder arthrodesis in a 50-year-old woman with a leiomyosarcoma of her left proximal humerus. Chemo and radiotherapy was administered as neoadjuvant treatment. In this case, we perform a shoulder arthrodesis with the technique described by Mario O'Connor from the Mayo Clinic, with an intercalary allograft to reconstruct the proximal humerus defect and a free fibula flap bypassing the defects to allow the bony union between the scapula and the humerus. The vascularized fibula graft is used to an adjunct in an attempt to promote early osseous union. This is the functional result and the bony union of the fibula flap. Tumor involving the proximal humerus in children are challenging. Normally, the main indication in proximal humerus tumor in infant at the orthopedic oncological department in my hospital is to perform an osteoarticular allograft, as you can see in this case with a Ewing sarcoma of the right proximal humerus in an infant of 13 years old. However, one of the complications is a fragmentation and resorption of the epiphysis, as you can see in this case at 7 year follow-up. In general, considering an allograft to have failed when it was removed through either any type of revision procedure or an amputation, the allograft survival at 10 years is 55%. The vascularized fibular epiphyseal transfer permits theoretically growth, function, and remodeling of the neoglenofibular joint and is associated with low donor morbidity site, as described by Marco Innocenti. However, the few studies reported with this technique show that longitudinal growth was obtained, but remodeling of the fibular epiphyse was not always accomplished. Even more, complications include transient nerve palsy of the peroneal nerve and fractures of the flap. The following case is very interesting because it falls apart from our normal indication of free vascularized bone graft, and this is a not reported reconstruction of the proximal humerus. This is the case of 11 years old girl suffering from a Ewing sarcoma of her proximal humerus. She followed the neoadjuvant chemotherapy as a protocol, and the preoperative virtual planning of the oncological team showed that in order to save part of the humeral head, the resection would produce the desvascularization of the remnant head. Thus, to avoid necrosis of the humeral head and the use of an osteoarticular allograft, a free fibula flap was planned to revascularize the humeral head. After the tumor resection, the humeral head rests attached to the supraspinatus tendon. A free fibula flap with the humeral allograft was used to reconstruct the bony defects. The allograft was applied as an on-glide graft to increase the stability of the reconstruction, to avoid future fractures, and to allow a rigid fixation in the proximal humerus. The circumflex vessels serve as a recipient pedicle. At 3 month follow-up, there was consolidation of the fibula graft, but more interesting is the periosteal consolidation at the humeral head than we can observe in the CT scan that helped to revascularize the humeral head. At 2 year follow-up, she had a painless limited range of motion of the shoulder with no signs of humeral head necrosis. Of course, we attend a longer follow-up to describe the technique. Finally, I will present some cases of digital defects. When only one finger is compromised by a tumor like this woman of 55 years old woman with a chondrosarcoma of her first phalanx of the middle finger, amputation of the ray is an excellent option since it could accomplish the oncological treatment as well as a functional and aesthetic hand. In this case, we perform a second ray transfer to the third metacarpal to avoid scissoring of the index and ring finger. This reconstruction allows for an early rehabilitation to obtain a functional hand. In contrast, amputation of the thumb, which is involved by a tumor, leads to a great functional impairment. In these cases, a reconstruction should be planned like in this 38 years old woman with an epithelial sarcoma of her right thumb. The patient has distant disease at the omolateral forearm as well as in the lungs. So after discussing the survival rate, we plan a reconstruction of the thumb that allow the patient an early use of her dominant hand. According to the prognosis, we perform a polycization of the index finger. Although this reconstruction is not the most aesthetic one, it allows a quickly return to daily life activities. The last case is about a 74 years old man, musician who was referred by the dermatologist because of squamous cell carcinoma on his dominant thumb. The MRI showed that in the deep plane, the tumor was in close contact with the phalanx, the distal phalanx of the thumb. So the resection was planned, including part of the phalanx together with the tumor. In this case, different from the previous one, with a good prognosis and with a high functional requirement because of his profession, non-onycho osteocutaneous transfer of the great toe was planned. The resection of the tumor include part of the distal phalanx, an onycho osteocutaneous flap of the omolateral great toe was harvested, the dissection of the vascular pedicle was in a retrograde manner, the flap was prepared, and the donor site was closed directly. The flap in setting show a good contour, Microanastomosis of the artery and nerve were performed at the level of the first phalanx in the mid-lateral approach, and the microanastomosis of the vein was performed through a separate dorsal approach. This is the aesthetic result at 2 years follow-up and the functional result at the donor and recipient site. The patient could return to his previous profession. In this video, he is performing La Comparsita, the most famous tango. In summary, microsurgical techniques allow for reconstruction of soft tissue of bony defects in patients after tumor resection. In our department, we prefer a stage reconstruction over immediate reconstruction in order to be sure about the complete resection of the tumor. When planning the reconstruction, we have to be aware of the patient prognosis and the systemic condition to avoid complications. The location and size of the defect has to be taken into consideration in order to get an aesthetic and functional reconstruction while minimizing donor site morbidity. Thank you so much.